We're going to talk about what we do in dentistry and how it affects the bone. This is my pride and joy, my queen, Marisa, and then my four boys, Keaton, Chase, Brooks, and Landon. By the way, Brooks is this tall now. Yes, he is my son. He just got some recessive genes, apparently. But they are everything to me. This is where I practice in Bountiful, Utah. Beautiful. Do I have to give an AGD disclaimer? I will regardless. I do have a financial interest. I do a education series. This year is the first annual holistic dental education series. And so my interest is in training other dentists to do what I do so that we can make people's lives better. So if I see further, it's because I stand on the shoulders of giants. And that's me quoting Sir Isaac Newton. Giants like Drs. Witzig, Spall, Huggins, Grubby, Levy, Tennant, Evans, Mollick, Harris, so many more. I couldn't fit everybody on the slide, but truly they are some of my giants. They are my heroes in dentistry. I really look up to them. So what are we going to do today? Hopefully have a little bit of fun looking at cases of ischemic bone disease, root canals, oral galvanism, understand the effects of metals and traditional dental materials on bone and other oral tissues, understand the correlation between dead organs, root canal treated teeth, necrotic teeth, and ischemic bone disease, and then understand how ischemic bone disease affects implant planning. So this is just a few cases from a typical day. I thought you might want to see some of these. I always like to see, you know, oh yeah, I had a patient like that. Oh, maybe I can try that. So hopefully something here will stimulate some thoughts in your minds. Patient comes in and he says, presents with this, and he's got horrible health issues. And I tell him some of the things that we need to do. And he says, but the dentist just did that root canal. Right? How many of you ever heard that? Well, here's what we find clinically. And every tooth in his head was crowned. Bleach BL1 shade. So we go in there and start moving this around and take a look at just some of this putrefaction that starts to come out. I wonder what degree of endodontic therapy is going to take care of that toxic mess. It's not. We're fooling ourselves to think that a root canal therapy is going to cure that problem. But wait, it gets better. I can't remember if it's on this slide or the next. If it's not, okay, yeah, it is on this one. The afterbirth. What degree of endodontic therapy is going to take care of that? It isn't going to happen. And do we want it to? I mean, even if you could, even it would take 2 years for that to clear up with the perfectly done root canal, why would we subject our patients to that type of insult? It doesn't make sense. And then got an implant in it afterwards. This is cool. So his blood pressure, which he'd been monitoring routinely, was consistently 150 over 95. Okay, so not terrible hypertension, but that's enough to be at risk for, you know, a possible heart attack, myocardial infarction, stroke. Overnight dropped to 120 and 70, and it has not risen above that since we cleaned up. And that was one of many toxic areas in his mouth, but that's nice. I like to see that. Another patient comes in and she says, oh, this is killing me. And I thought immediately of Wilson, you know, where's the ice skate? Get that tooth out of my head because it hurts so bad. You must not have seen Castaway. Okay. You know, it hurts really, really bad. So we get it out. And sure enough, we've got this pathology at the apex. Shortly after, an onlay had been placed on that tooth. So there's nowhere for those gases to go because it's very tightly bound in that bond, but down. So we put it under a microscope, and what do we see? Holy cow, she's just loaded with... Anybody know what these are? Say it loud. Yeah, parasites, amoeba. All over the place. And I wanted to compare, you know, what does this look like compared to normal blood? not a systemic infection, but somehow those amoeba were creating an intense pain. So I thought, okay, well, it's just an isolated case. But I've seen multiple others over the last few weeks of amoeba contributing to a periapical radiolucency and pathology and extreme pain. So you may want to just take a little dab of your extracted tooth, put it on a slide, stick it under your microscope, and see what you find. You know, it may be telling, maybe they do have some gut issues. And then we restored it, trying to mimic Mother Nature, root for root. If you want to learn more about that, we're going to talk about case studies ad nauseum in April, next month, down in Carlsbad. How about this? Some major digestive problems. I wonder. Yeah, I like to call that my dental narwhal. It sits, number 14 sits on the stomach meridian. So of course you got something up there like a lightning rod that's going to disrupt that whole energy chain. The gut is not going to be happy, not to mention all the pathogens that live around here. Another patient, bedridden, nauseated, 24/7. How many, raise of hands, how many of you have ever been nauseated for more than 5 minutes? Raise your hands high, I want to see, so I know how many of you understand what we're talking about. All the time. We get this out immediately. Upright, nausea is gone. Is it a coincidence? No, look at all the pathogens and toxins that come out of this. Healthy teeth are not black. So she considered this a miracle, and a definition of a miracle is an amazing product or achievement or an outstanding example of something. And in my experience, it's usually been heaven sent. And my recommendation would be make sure you give credit where credit is due. Another, I'm not sure what this is, but it shouldn't have been there. Cavitation area down in the bone. Horrible digestion issues prior to this treatment. It reminds me of family reunion frog eye salad. Sorry, I just ruined that for all of you. Up close, this is what we're looking at. Lots of dark material. I have a suspicion that a lot of this dark material is probably dry socket paste that just never resorbed. You know, it's supposed to resorb. That's what they tell us in dental school. It doesn't. It stays in the cavitation and causes major problems. Another example, I think this is dry socket paste that was never removed. Okay, big part of the cavitation. We cannot leave these in people's bodies and expect them to get better. You have to be looking, and you have to be prepared to know how to treat it, get it cleaned out. Okay, Dr. Lechner. Again, I should have put him on my slide of giants, because he, holy cow, one of the greatest researchers who is also a private practitioner in the practice of dental medicine. He has done a lot of recent research about Rontase and CCL5. This is a paper published in 2015 that showed a 30 times increase of Rontase CCL5 in areas of cavitations. So what does that mean? Well, Rontase is a cytokine, member of the interleukin 8 family of cytokines, and it is responsible for pretty much every disease of chronic inflammation. So I did a little literature search to see, I just typed in jawbone, Rontase, CCL5, 58 results. By the way, most of those are Dr. Lechner's published. Periodontitis, over 1,000. Non-Hodgkin lymphoma, 2,300. Prostate cancer, breast cancer, melanoma. You see the numbers getting larger. Take a look at this. Heart disease and Rontase, CCL5. Over 13,000 connections. I hope the wheels are spinning so that you can be thinking, holy cow, might I actually be able to contribute to decreasing the number one and number two causes of death in the United States, at least in 2016? That's what we should be thinking as oral physicians. How can we change our patients' lives for the better? Some other studies just showing the connection between Rontase and inflammation, Rontes, and chronic inflammation, this one with MS, CCL. By the way, CCL5 and Rontes are the same thing. It's called Rontes in Europe, CCL5 in the United States. This one shows that the CCL5 or Rontes contributes to hypercoagulation. So think with me through this. If a cavitation is caused by hypercoagulation, not enough blood to the area, then this is going to happen. Get high CCL5 levels, which leads to hypercoagulation, which leads to more ischemic bone disease, and you just got this dog chasing its tail. So where do we fit in as dentists? Let's clean it up. Get rid of one of the sources of Rontes and CCL5. Silent inflammation. This one was just published by Dr. Lechner in 2017. This is a medical paper published in Journal of Physiology and Pharmacology showing the connection between Rontes and early stages of coronary heart disease. So we need to be thinking outside the dental box more systemically. This one showing the connection between Rontes and insulin, so diabetes or diabetic patients. More video. You start looking around titanium, you're also going to see these things routinely. Mucositis, peri-implantitis. The incidence of peri-implantitis, paramucositis is going through the roof. Are you supposed to have pus around an implant? I don't think so. And look at all the pitting corrosion. And all of this mucositis. Okay, this was published just this month in the Journal of Dental Research. We need to ask ourselves, what's being released in response to these metals? What's happening in the corrosion and the corrosive process? Should we be putting metals in people's mouths 2 inches from the brainstem? I don't think so. More of the same. I've got hundreds of these videos. Look at all the pitting corrosion, the mucositis. That is not a healthy situation. This one was published last month, showing the incidence close to 50% of peri-implant mucositis in screw-retained titanium implants. Now, my theory on that is that, yeah, you might have a matching or somewhat close to matching type of material in the implant body itself and in the abutment, but what about the screw? What's the screw made out of? Well, now you've got maybe 6 or 7 dissimilar metals all connected, shooting a lightning rod down into the bone. This is from Dr. Lechner last month in San Diego. This is going to stir up a lot of intense debate, especially on those people using titanium implants. But this is what he showed in his research. Titanium implant is placed. Titanium particles dissolve, causes an acute inflammatory reaction, mainly through macrophage activation. TNF-alpha goes through the roof. That's why these people swell up like crazy when they get titanium implants. You get an upregulation, and then that happens for several weeks. TNF-alpha drops off, then Rontes CCL5 rises quite quickly over the next several months and years, then leading to all of these healthcare issues. So this is pretty hot research from Dr. Lechner. And here's the TNF-alpha, sharp crash, and then Rontes moving up. And he's finding a 10 times higher than normal level of Rontes CCL5 in the bone around titanium implants. So our questions that we should ask ourselves, should we be putting titanium, something that contributes to high levels of chronic inflammatory cytokine, in people's jaws, especially when there are over 500,000 of these placed in people's jaws per year in the United States?
Hi, Dr. Wall. We just wanted to let you know you're the luckiest guy to be working with us. Because we work all day long.
Yeah. That's why I am like I am. They're awesome assistants. I couldn't do what I do without them. Another situation, this patient, asymptomatic, didn't hurt. But she had really poor digestion, autoimmune disorders, anxiety, and skin issues. When did pain become the only reason for us to do something? It shouldn't be. Does high blood pressure hurt? Heart disease, does it hurt? Sleep apnea hurt? Diabetes, hypothyroidism, you get the idea, cirrhosis. Pain should not be our only motivating factor for helping our patients. We need to inform them. It doesn't mean we have to treat, but we have to inform. All right, 6 millimeter pocket, round number 2. Spirochetes, motile rods, just the whole gamut. And Shelby, I see you back there. I know this just makes you want to go in there and do all that great stuff that you do. Okay. This is at the CEJ of number 19. I would say equally pathologic. So pocket depth isn't necessarily the only indicator for periodontal and systemic health. And thank you, Shelby, for bringing that to my attention. Another, periapical radiolucency and irreversible pulpitis on 31. What do you think about that? You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy. I call that dental dysentery. Loaded with all of these parasites. Same patient, different swab, same tooth. We got to be looking at these things. And she's got major gut issues. So we got to be oral physicians, not just tooth doctors. Not just think about, okay, how are we going to replace that tooth? What's going on down the line? We did go ahead and replace the tooth. Another situation. It's one of my favorite videos of all time. And it never ceases to please, apparently. But my dentist said I just needed a root canal. Her whole sinus was full and it just kept draining, kept draining, kept draining. So you gotta let that heal. Sometimes do a sinus lift where necessary, restore that physiology and then restore it appropriately. I don't know how this fishing line got in here. But that can happen. And then the patient's experiencing extreme pain because that nerve has calcified. This patient was picking up Christmas songs in July without the radio being on. More of the same, more of the dry socket paste. We got to be looking for these things. This patient presented a referral from a naturopath I work with. Actually, his mother, and had some major digestive issues. Unfortunately, we didn't catch this soon enough. As you can see, that's definitely not bone. Number one area. 3 months after this, she passed away from stage 4 colon cancer. And remember, what sits on this energy pathway right here? Number 1, 16, 17, 32. All of the gut. So that's sitting there for 40, 50 years, releasing Rontase CCL5 into this patient's system, contributing to chronic inflammatory disease. Well, let's not wait the 40, 50 years. Better yet, let's not take out the wisdom teeth. You don't have to in most situations. Leave them alone. Oh, gotta see this.
Well, the same, no sun to dry. Got the tack red line, throttle open wide. Jump start on the engines. Got all new diagnostic tune, polish and lure. I knew this car will blow your mind and your door right off. Rotated tires, balance line, high stop pain, money get mine. She looks like she's flying when she's sitting at a stop. You'll go straight getting garbage. There's nothing next to mine. This ain't no Sunday drive.
Alrighty. So, osteonecrosis has been around for a long time, and it was discovered clear back in the 1800s, when they didn't know what it was, but they had to call it something. And then it goes through the 1900s, late 1900s. Jerry Foucault is also one of those great giants that should have been on my first slide, has done more for cavitation research than I think than anybody else. It's described, mentioned, defined in 23 textbooks. So why aren't we talking about it? Because we're afraid of our state boards? We cannot practice in fear. We need to practice out of charity. We care about our patients. Just because the state board might come to your office, knock on your door, by the way, I'm speaking from experience, and say, we're here to investigate you. And as the, I think I'm kind of kind-hearted, I invited him in and said, come on in, have a smoothie, let's sit down and talk. I should have said, no, I'm going to call my lawyer. But they came in, we can't be afraid of that happening. You will always come out on top if you do the right thing for the right reason. It's in, thank you. We treat people how we want to be treated, and that will always come out on top. Truth always rises. The most popular endodontic textbook talks about it, and also the Bible of Oral Medicine. It's mentioned in one of the research papers is mentioned back in 1991 in the Journal of Endodontics. So there's plenty of scientific literature to back what we're doing as we're trying to treat patients with their systemic issues. So what is it? It's a local reaction to a systemic or local factor that will decrease blood supply. That's the key. So as we're thinking about what decreases the blood supply, we need to think, what do we do in dentistry that is decreasing the blood supply? Don't raise your hands, but are you using epinephrine? If you are, you shouldn't be. Go home and get rid of it. The only epinephrine you should have is in your emergency box. Don't use it. Vasoconstriction is death to bone and death to other tissue and death to teeth. How about root canals? Remember, bacteremia causes hypercoagulation through that cascade. Deep caries. Sometimes we can't save teeth. Sometimes we shouldn't try to save a tooth. It will cause the patient more harm. What about overheating the tooth, not using proper irrigation, or an infected PDL? There are plenty of great alternatives to epinephrine. This is my favorite. Prilocaine and mepivacaine mixed. 99% of the patients, you're going to get profound anesthesia for at least 45 minutes. I know that's not 3 hours, but you're not getting the vasoconstriction, you're not getting the cellular death, and it's much kinder to the tissue. Also consider conscious sedation. If you haven't treated a sedated patient yet, you need to. It's nirvana. You know they're comfortable, you're comfortable, you do better dentistry when you're comfortable, right? You're not worried about, oh, is that anesthetic going to wear off? Are they going to feel this? Are they going to flinch? So consider that. Conscious sedation is awesome. Bacteremias can cause problems, activates complement, which then causes this clotting factor cascade. The bacteria themselves will inhibit fibrinolysis, which then will create more of a clot, and then you get more fibrin deposed, which then can contribute to an infarct or an area of dead tissue. Dr. Levy, is he in here? If not, I just want to give a shout out because he is awesome. This book, if you have not read it yet, you need to buy 3 cases and give them to every patient that you have. It will come back into your practice 20-fold. Because people will read this, they will become missionaries for your practice. They will become missionaries for good oral health. All infections and all toxins cause oxidative stress. We need to minimize the amount of oxidative stress that we're causing patients long term. Another study, 2014 shows that sepsis contributes to thromboses. So let's minimize the sepses that we're contributing in dentistry, like root canal therapy. Use ozone, use a laser, be biomimetic, avoid crowns. If you do a crown, make sure you seal it so that the bacteria don't get down in these tubules. Look at the patient's digestion to make sure the ion flow is going correctly. So you don't want the ions being pulled out of the tooth, which happens when patients aren't having good digestion. You want them being put into the teeth. There's a hydrostatic pressure theory. As the body draws calcium from the bones in the teeth, it creates a surge towards the pulp, which then the bacteria can hop onto, especially in deep caries, which then can create a bacteremia in the pulp. And then if the pH of the environment is conducive to microbial growth, it might propagate, create a colony that's silent. Maybe half the tooth is alive, half the tooth is dead. Anybody else totally frustrated by that? You got 3 or 14, 3 roots. Is it 20% dead? Is it 80% alive? I guess that's the same thing. I'm being redundant. But you get the idea. How much of that tooth is alive? And should we try and save it? For me, that's one of the daily challenges that I'm up against. So muscle testing, energy testing can be very helpful in figuring that out. We want to avoid hypercoagulation. Okay, another published article, well-known, 1995 in the Journal of Endodontics. Non-vital, root canal treated tooth, 40% of the tubules occluded. Vital tooth, I guess before it was extracted, very small, 1% invaded tubules. We want to avoid this scenario. This is chronic inflammation. This is rontase. This is contributing to the leading causes of death in the United States. Okay, Ceramir. One of the best cements I know of that is as close to dentin enamel structures as we can get. It's not, doesn't have any bonding strength, but so you got to make sure your preparations are quite as close to parallel as possible, but this is the kindest I've seen to dentin of all the cements that I've used.
This guy wins a manly for taking on an even manlier pickup.
Yeah, so be smart, you know, in what you do. If something doesn't make sense, don't do it. Ischemic bone disease can occur in every bone. It's most common in the hip, knee, and the jaw. 1/3 of all hip replacements develop ischemic bone disease. That was astounding when I heard that. It's the third most common disease, bone disease, after arthritis and osteoporosis. So the medical side gets this. They understand what's going on. I don't know why our dental colleagues don't wake up and smell the coffee. So what can lead to ischemic bone disease? Epinephrine, sitting in the dental chair, endogenous release of epinephrine, doing too much or trying to do too much dental treatment, putting a gold crown on or next to a mercury filling, seating two PFMs or gold crowns or any mixture of metals in the mouth, cutting without irrigation, trying to save a hopeless tooth, root canal treatment, metal implants, leaving roots of extractions, leaving dry socket paste in extraction sites, insufficient vitamin D3, and many others. This is my 18-year-old Chase. First back rip he landed. That was a couple years ago. Now he's doing all kinds of crazy things. I'm surprised he's still alive, actually. My favorite way to diagnose these cavitations is with a cone beam scan. And this is out of Carl Misch's implant book. D1 bone, Hounsfield units, very, very dense. D2, D3. My opinion is this is cavitation. And then even D5 when you start to see negative numbers. So you start to see low numbers, Hounsfield units, that should be a red flag that says I need to explore this a little bit further. And this is how you look for them. Just go through your cone beam, all three dimensions, and go through and look for these areas where you can pick out those dark spots. Don't try and read them from two-dimensional x-rays. It's not going to work. This is clear back in 1961 in the JADA. Sectioned a cadaver jawbone. Cleaned out the bone, took another x-ray, looks identical. You can't see these on two-dimensional x-rays. You got to have a cone beam. That's the standard. Normal bone histology looks like this. This is what you're going to see when you, if you look at it under a microscope or a histologist is going to look at. Bone marrow edema. All of this stuff going on. That's not normal. And by the way, let the pathologist make the diagnosis. We just make the differential to get them in the chair so they can have a diagnosis. Normal fatty bone marrow of the jaws never has fibrous tissue, never has fluid between the adipocytes, never has marrow hemorrhage when you hand curettage, never has inflammatory cells between the fat cells, and there are no oily cysts. If you see any of that, you're in a cavitation. And this is from Dr. Bucot. Okay, you drop into these sites and then you see all this fat come to the surface. That's a fatty, oily cyst. That's a telltale sign. If my assistant would stop suctioning it up, you can see. Here it comes. Wait for it. Yeah, chicken noodle soup coming to the surface. Here we go. You also see this wispy bone that tried to heal but couldn't quite make it. That you'll send to the pathologist. And they make that any sample you can get out of there, put in your jar. Chase again, that's just across the street from our house in Bountiful. Fatty exudate. Saponification of the fat. It's a telltale sign that you're in a cavitation. It's another thing it looks like. For tinier lesions, I like to be a little more conservative and just pop through with an X-tip, flood this full of ozone gas, and then follow it up with some IPRF. IPRF. Injectable PRF. And that's the key. You want to get it to bleed like that. With bleeding comes healing. Blood is liquid bone. Okay, you've all seen this before. Similar to wet gangrene. It's very difficult to read on a 2D x-ray. Hollow tuberosity, you'll drop into these things and you'll think, holy cow, where's the brain? They're so deep. Sometimes you'll just see a hole. You just flap this and you just got, what's that crater in Hawaii? The non-active volcano. There you go. Okay, you're also going to see it where you've got metals that are next to each other and root canals. This one happened to be dystrophic calcification. That's orthopathognomonic for osteonecrosis. This is what it looked like on the cone beam slice, two-dimensional x-ray. Also had a nice lesion going on here. Let's see. So with regards to metals, here are a bunch of published research, some of them in our dental journals. This one's in 0000, saying that oral galvanism induces changes in the cells in vitro that closely simulate some of the morphologic features of squamous cell carcinoma. 2012, and we're still putting metal in people's heads? How many of our colleagues do you think read this article? Okay, dissimilar metals are going to affect the bone. Galvanism affects the immune system. Especially in women, contributing to allergy. Metal removal decreases inflammation. So if you want some ammunition, you need to defend your status, why you're doing what you're doing, use these papers. Go into PubMed and type in oral galvanism or metals and mouth and health. PubMed is one of the greatest godsends to our profession, to holistic dentists. Use it. New studies are put up there every single day. This is typically what you'll find. You pop off. Anybody have any heartache about taking out crowns when there's no sign of decay? I did. until 99% of these I take out, this is what I see underneath. Take pictures of everything you do. Take video of everything you do. Show the patients. Again, they'll be missionaries for holistic dentistry. More of the same. Now in this, how are you going to detect this decay under that crown? You're not going to see it. Ultimately, let the patient decide. You say, show them a picture like this. This is what I typically see. Do you want to get them changed out? You are respecting, according to the ADA, that patient's autonomy. That's pretty high on the ADA code of ethics list, although I don't put much stock in the ADA. This one, metals-induced liver and kidney damage, toxicity, and you see this routinely. Corrosion, decay, toxic materials, PFM, five or six different metals on top of a mercury filling. Really? We need to be smarter. Metals contribute to oral lichen planus.
I'm worried about little Dilbert. He's not like other kids.
What do you mean?
Yesterday, I left him alone for a minute, and he disassembled the TV, our clock, and the stereo.
That's perfectly normal. Kids take things apart.
Oh! The part that worries me is he used the components to build a ham radio set.
Oh, dear.
Is that bad?
Normally, I'd want to run an EEG on him, but the machine isn't working. It's worse than I feared.
What is it?
I'm afraid your son has the knack.
The knack?
The knack. It's a rare condition characterized by an extreme intuition about all things mechanical and electrical, and utter social ineptitude.
Can he lead a normal life?
No. He'll be an engineer.
I hope we don't have any engineers in here. If you do, it's all in good jest. All right, so we need to ask ourselves, when we see that on the surface, what's going on underneath? What's going on in the tooth, in the tubules, with the odontoblasts? What's going on with the bone and the bone cells, osteoblasts? Osteoclasts. What are we doing to that tissue? Galvanism creates inflammation, and not just inflammation that stays local, it travels. This particular one says you should replace these alloys whenever there is a suitable alternative. Well, there is. We have so many good materials to use now. There's no reason to use metal. Then gold right over mercury, and then right next to mercury, there is a better way. Especially when the manufacturers say, do not place dental amalgams in direct contact with other types of metals in the brochure that comes with the product. This one shows that the corrosion in the implants, titanium implants, not just local, it travels. This is a favorite slide. I show this to all my patients. I say, you do have an option, not in my office, because I'm not giving you titanium. If you want titanium, you can go somewhere else. But you do have an option, titanium or zirconia. Take your pick. Lots of diagnostic terms. Be familiar with these so that you can put in your notes, this is my differential diagnosis. This is what I think is going on. To keep it really simple, every time I put in differential diagnosis, ischemic bone disease. Very short, sweet, you've covered your bases. Your final diagnosis, of course, comes back from the pathologist, which you also put in the record, and usually will correspond with what you mentioned in your differential. But there are four pages of all these different things. Treatments, different treatments. Needle aspiration, then fumigation. That's the conservative. And for tiny areas that, in my opinion, wouldn't warrant a full-blown flap curettage, at least start out in that position, especially if you've got a patient that's a little tepid. For larger areas, I highly recommend curettage, laser, ozone, PRF. I'll show you my exact protocol in a minute. possible anticoagulant therapy, sometimes just an aspirin a day, just to keep that blood from hypercoagulating and creating another problem. Sometimes antibiotics are indicated. I don't use them routinely. And other drugs, hyperbaric chamber, neurotherapy, there's an interesting article we'll look at in a minute. Acupuncture can help that energy flow properly. And then you also want to make sure that you're versed in reducing other pains, because remember we're dealing with the trigeminal nerve, which is both motor and sensory. So we've got to be aware of what are the other things that can contribute to the same symptoms that the cavitations might be leading to, like myofascial pain, disc displacement with reduction or without reduction. And that will also help increase the blood flow and help bring their parasympathetic, sympathetic back into balance. Example of X-tip, very simple. Sometimes you don't even need to get them numb. You just pop through, cortical plate, slide that off the sleeve. Don't use your finger like I did. That was really dumb. Use an instrument, and then you'll see the saponification, but very rapidly afterwards, you see some bleeding. Now, if that were continuing to ooze out fat, I might think twice about opening this up surgically. But I've got good bleeding here. So then we'll pop in with some ozone. Bubble, bubble, bubble. And a lot of times there's a cavitation back here that you've already opened. Don't close it until you finish this, because you want to see that ozone bubble out the back and flush out that area. Because remember, this whole jaw is connected. You've got these complex caverns and trabeculae, and sometimes you may need to do multiple sites, especially if you want to get up and stir up this maxillary sinus disease, help get that cleaned out. Okay, curettage, of course, you make your surgical opening and then scoop out all this, the nasty stuff, get it clean. And you know you're on the right track when you start to see quite a bit of bleeding. I'm not even close here, because this is just pooling fatty necrotic tissue in the back. See all the fat coming to the surface. And then, yes, the assistant just suctioned my biopsy. That was not a good day. Oh. Okay, this is the neuromodulation therapy, published 2009. Find a chiropractor that knows how to do it, and for patients that are adamant about not wanting to do surgery, this shows, at least in this situation, it worked to help re-densify cavitated areas. How? I don't know. I don't know how to do this technique yet. Probably outside of my scope. So my protocol, I want to make sure patients have vitamin D level bare minimum 50. I'd like to see them up around 70 to 90 nanograms per milliliter. And then, whenever possible, make sure that they're under IV sedation to be treated. I'm fortunate to have my neighbor's husband and wife, nurse anesthetist team. So, you know, I've got ready access to them whenever. So find one. I would recommend that. That'll make your life so much nicer. And I would highly recommend, don't do it yourself, unless you already know how to do it and you're used to doing it. Don't take that extra stress on yourself. You focus on the dentistry, let them focus on keeping the patient alive so you can do the dentistry. Piezo and hand curettage, clean it out, ozonated sodium chloride, sodium bicarb, then the erbium YAG with the sweeps goes in and sends these turbocharges into the bone and obliterates any nasties that are in there. Also helps to stimulate the blood flow. Then ozone gas, 11 micrograms per milliliter, more curettage, irrigate again. Remember, dilution is the solution to pollution. Fill with PRF once it's bleeding, bright red, clean blood, suture it, and make sure you're doing vitamin C, IV. I like to do 20 grams the day of the surgery, during the surgery, and then also 20 grams the day after. Lymphatic massage also the day after, because you want all that stuff to flow. You don't want the lymph to become stagnant. We'll also use low-level laser, pulsed electromagnetic frequency, frequency-specific microcurrent, everything you throw at that to decrease inflammation, increase blood flow, decrease pain, get the patient back into parasympathetic, sympathetic balance. And then post-operative supplements also help with that. Look to the bone. How much time have I got? None?